What happens when we pass away? This might be the most fascinating question in the history of humanity. And it's a question that everyone has asked, but no one knows the exact answer. Because no one who has been on the other side has ever come back to tell us what exactly happens after we close our eyes for the last time. But what if I told you that there is a way for us to discover, at least partially, some clues to this puzzle? And this could be possible in some ways thanks to individuals who didn't die, but who were dangerously close to that thin line separating the living from the non-living, and who somehow managed to stay among us. In this video, we'll try to decipher near-death experiences. This name, that can be abbreviated to NDE, is derived from studies conducted by French psychologist Victor Egger in 1800s. But it was only in 1975 that the theme gained global popularity. It was the year when the American psychiatrist Raymond Moody published the book Life After Life. This book broke the academic bubble, became a global bestseller, and remains a vital reference for scholars of this subject to this day. But before we delve into near-death experiences, first we need to ask ourselves what exactly is nearly dying. In the legal sense of the word, death is brain death, but several near-death experiences seem to be associated with cases where people experience an imminent risk of dying, such as when they stopped breathing, or the heart stopped beating, or the blood stopped circulating. In the past, at various times, these were irreversible. But thanks to technological advancements, such as defibrillators and techniques like the cardiopulmonary resuscitation maneuvers, there are people who manage to reverse the situation. And it is during these seconds or even minutes in this state that some people have what are called near-death experiences. The accounts of what exactly happens during an NDE vary somewhat, but there are some patterns. In the book Life After Life, the author gathered about 150 testimonials. He came up with a list of 9 points that seem to be common to almost all cases. First, patients report an intense buzzing in the ear. Then, a feeling of peace and absence of pain. After that, the experience of being out of one's own body, entering a tunnel, ascending, levitating, seeing deceased individuals, meeting spiritual beings, reviewing moments of one's own life, and feeling hesitation and doubt about whether or not to return to the embrace of life's existence. And again, this is not necessarily what happens in every recorded case, but these are some more common points. There are also other reports, such as of heightened senses and even of omniscient vision, as if the person could see at once everything that is happening in the hospital room where they are admitted, for example. Finally, patients report a door or physical boundary like a lake that, if crossed, prevents them from returning to the material existence here on Earth, leaving them unable to come back. Some even captured on canvas what they saw during a near-death experience. The British artist Shiv Grewal, clinically dead for 7 minutes, painted pictures of what he remembers from that moment. You might even think this seems like something someone who used drugs would do, but know that a study has already been conducted to compare these cases. Researchers from Johns Hopkins University in the United States divided more than 3,000 people into two groups. One who had an NDE without using any chemical substance, and another with people who have had psychedelic experiences with the use of drugs. The result indicated similarities. In both groups, the majority of participants reported experiencing a revelation about the meaning of life and a reduction in their fear of death. In the case of those who had an NDE, the experience was shorter, lasting less than 5 minutes for 40% of the people, compared to 7% in the group that used psychedelic drugs. And other studies show that near-death experiences are more common than many people think. In the 80s, North American research indicated that between 30% and 40% of people who came close to death had some kind of experience. And at the time, this was equivalent to about 5% of the entire adult population of the United States. But in fact, there are other accounts long before that. The first instance of something like an NDE is in a text by Plato, a Greek philosopher who lived 400 years before the Common Era. In the 10th book of his work, The Republic, he mentions the story of a soldier who was presumed dead on a battlefield, but who came back to life and spoke about what he saw in the afterlife. The scene he described was that of a kind of trial. People who had already died heard their final sentences to know where they would go from that moment on. However, the most frequent and well-known current reports are of individuals who encounter certain complications while undergoing surgery, for instance. They then leave their own body and are able to look at themselves kind of from the outside. I will highlight 3 cases of this type documented by the University of Virginia in the United States, The first is from Laura Gaines, who was 12 years old when she needed to have her tonsils removed. She reported that during the operation, she saw her own body surrounded by a doctor and two nurses who seemed very worried. She then left the operating room and went to look for her mother, who was no longer in the waiting room. The mother had taken the chair from the waiting room to a hospital corridor. After the surgery, when she returned to her normal life, she finally asked her mother why she had moved the chair that day. Her mother was surprised by the question, as the girl had no other way of knowing what happened during surgery. Another case is that of Al Sullivan. After undergoing bypass surgery, he said he watched his own operation from above and that a gesture from the surgeon caught his attention. He said that the doctor moved his arms in a curious way, as if he were trying to flap wings. After the surgery, the doctor explained that behavior. He said that to avoid touching contaminated surfaces, he chooses to rest his hands on his chest and use his elbows to point and give instructions to the team. The report surprised people, as the patient couldn't see this during the surgery. And the third case is one of the most well-known cases of NDE ever documented, of singer Pam Reynolds. She had a brain aneurysm, and to try to save her life, the doctors needed to kill her for a few moments. To remove blood from the singer's brain, surgeons left her clinically dead. Body kept at 10 degrees Celsius, heart stopped, all under doctors' watchful eyes. They successfully conducted surgery. When she woke from sedation, she surprised the team with detailed account of instruments used and nurses' conversations. Keep in mind, the entire environment was controlled, and the medical team confirms the patient was clinically dead during the incident. But whether in Plato's book, in the works of Art of a Painter, or in university publications, everything we have dealt with so far here were accounts. Descriptions made by people, and people can be dishonest. They overstate. They forget. Or even when they obtain some highly specific detail correctly, it could all simply be a stroke of luck. We can't, in good conscience, ignore this. There are 7 billion people alive and, I don't know, about 100 million undergo surgeries each year. Even in pure luck, someone will manage to guess exactly what happened in a surgery room when they were out. So, in addition to the accounts, what else does science know about near-death experiences? One of the leading names in this type of research is Professor Sam Parnia, who is the Director of Intensive Care and Resuscitation Research at the New York University School of Medicine. And he states that, since the creation of CPR techniques, death is no longer an absolute state, but rather a process that can be reversed in some individuals even after it has started. Parnia explains that when the brain stops receiving oxygen, irreversible damage to brain cells does not occur within a few minutes. This actually takes hours, and during this time, patients have near-death experiences. A study conducted by him monitored the brain activity of 567 patients who had cardiac arrest. Everyone underwent cardiopulmonary resuscitation maneuvers, and in some cases, the analysis found brain activity even when the patient's hearts were not beating and blood was not circulating. Gamma, delta, theta, alpha, and beta waves were detected. These are the 5 types of brain waves operating at different frequencies and responsible for everything we think or feel. That is, this would kind of be evidence indicating that our brain has the potential to stay active even in a state of technical death. But everything in science is subject to a second opinion, and this study was no different. One of the world's leading experts on NDEs, the professor of psychiatry at the University of Virginia, Bruce Grayson, criticized the alleged research findings. He said that this study on persistent brain waves after cardiac arrests was exaggerated by the media. Researcher Parnia's team did not demonstrate any connections between brain waves and conscious activity. Despite this criticism, Bruce Grayson defends the veracity of near-death experiences. The main theory he studies is that of the independence between mind and brain, that is, that our consciousness is not necessarily only in our brain. This is a very bold observation and is far from being established. Where else could consciousness be? He's unsure. But that's the answer he seeks by criticizing the current model of mind-brain dependence. An appropriate model of mind-brain interactions needs to be able to explain how consciousness can function so complexly during an NDE, noting that the act of thinking, sensory perception, and memory continue to occur during cardiac arrest or under general anesthesia. Current physiological models, which explain the functioning of the mind, consider such events impossible. Scientific discussions about the phenomenon of consciousness, to be intellectually responsible, need to take these data into account. Grayson compares this situation to the development of quantum physics, an analogy can be established with Newtonian mechanics, which seems to explain the physics of everyday life. It was only the investigation of extraordinary circumstances, involving distances, speeds, or extremely small or large masses, that revealed the limits of the Newtonian model and the need to develop additional explanatory models. And this also applies to the issue of understanding the mind-brain relationship. The exploration of extraordinary circumstances such as an NDE can reveal the limitations of this current model of understanding and the need to develop a more comprehensive explanatory model. In other words, it is often the questioning of something that seems natural that makes science progress. The questions are equally as important as the answers themselves, and in the search for the right answers, it is common for us to find wrong ones. Trial and error. The scientific method is exactly like that. In his research, for example, Grayson lists a series of non-explanations for NDEs. He says that, contrary to what many people might think, experiences are not tied to a specific profile. That is, the patients are mentally healthy individuals who do not differ in age, gender, ethnicity, religion, or mental health. Another hypothesis is that NDEs would be the result of people's imagination based on what they expect regarding death. Grayson rejects that version. He emphasizes young children with few death expectations have experiences like adults. And there are cases of people with experiences opposite to personal beliefs. Also, the assumption is that near-death experiences are caused by anoxia or hypoxia, i.e. the lack of oxygen in the body. But the researcher contests, arguing that comparisons made with the cases of fighter pilots, who also face loss of consciousness due to lack of oxygen, show very different reports. Furthermore, patients who undergo NDEs do not have the same symptoms as those who suffer from anoxia or hypoxia, like seizures, memory loss, disorientation upon awakening. Another hypothesis the study dismisses is that of hallucinations caused by medications. This is because near-death experiences are even less frequent in patients who receive medication. So then, as I hope it has been possible to notice so far, there are more doubts than certainties about this subject. Humanity is far from fully deciphering everything that involves these experiences. Different studies have even managed to understand certain aspects of near-death experiences, but none of them have fully unraveled how they occur. And it's possible this may never happen. The most likely scenario is the discovery of what awaits us after death will remain a mystery, one that cannot be solved by anyone, will be solved by everyone once it's our turn. Thank you, and see you next time.